Superyachts are fascinating craft to look at, but for me, even more fascinating is the way they're built and the engineering that goes into them. In this video, we'll take a look behind the scenes at how these boats are built, and a look at some of the engineering that goes into building these amazing craft. And for any aspiring yacht engineers, this video gives a look at another aspect of the job of a yacht engineer. The boat is created as a 3D model. From the model, hundreds of drawings are made, which the builders in the yard use to create the boat in reality. The hull starts life as a skeleton with frames, bulkheads and stringers that are cut, assembled and welded together. The actual skin of the hull is made from many small panels that are cut, rolled and welded in place. Most of the small to medium sized superyachts are built from aluminium. You also get quite a number of fiberglass or composite boats at the smaller end of the scale too. And on the bigger boats, the hulls are usually built from steel, and the superstructure, or the accommodation above the main deck, is built from aluminium or composite material. Once the hull and superstructure are complete, then the work starts with the installation of piping, insulation, electrical. It's really quite mind-boggling the amount of cables and pipework that go into a boat. When we get to the engine room later in the video, you'll see what I mean. To see the interior of these boats during the fit out is quite amazing. It's hard to imagine at this stage just how beautiful it all looks when it's finished. There's carpenters, plumbers, electricians, engineers, everybody working around each other. It's also equally impressive just how quickly it transforms from a workshop to a finished interior. This is the crew mess on one boat. For marine engineers, working on a yacht is quite a bit different to working on a commercial ship. Here's a small part of the audio-visual system. The entertainment system on these yachts is massive. The yachts have quite large and complex audio-visual systems and computer networks. These take up quite a bit of your time. Also the toys, jet skis, tenders and other watercraft, these need to be maintained as well. They're also something you don't have on a ship. This was going to be my bunk. We were leaving in 6 weeks. I was starting to get nervous. On some boats you need to share a cabin. On other boats you have your own. It's another difference to working on the ships. Sharing a cabin is not something you do on a ship. Down the engine room there's plenty to look at. It's like spaghetti down here, pipes and cables going everywhere. But it's a good chance with everything opened up to follow where everything goes. In the engine room, just like in the accommodation, there's plenty of protection used. Here's a brand new V16 MTU, nearly ready to be started up for the first time. By far the two most popular engines used in superyachts are the German MTUs and the American Caterpillars. my position on board was chief engineer. The engineer normally arrives in the final months of the build. It's a busy time, not just learning the boat. You work together with the shipyard's engineers, the classification society's surveyors, acceptance testing for all the systems and sea trials once she's in the water. Everything's getting tested. It's a long ongoing process, finding faults, making lists, getting them fixed, ticking them off the list. Also, all the tools and spare parts need to be decided on and ordered in. And finding enough room to store everything is always a headache. Here's one of the stabilizer fins, just prior to installation. It's only the passenger ships and ferries and commercial shipping that have these. They're installed either side of the hull to cut down on rolling when you're underway and also when you're at anchor. The zero speed stabilizers actually paddle when you're at anchor to stop the boat from rolling. Here we are in the propeller workshop. We had to go down and check the fit of the propeller on its shaft. They paint a blue dye on the taper on the shaft before fitting the propeller, so you can check afterwards for proper mating of the two taper surfaces. And here they are after delivery, installed on the boat. By now we were getting pretty close to the launch. The final deck work was being done, and the painting was well underway, with plastic everywhere. I think he'd lost his keys up the exhaust. This was the crew's office for the duration we were in the yard. Boats this size have normally two or three generators. This boat had two, and here they're being tested at just over 100% of their rated capacity, connected to load banks on the workshop floor. By now, the boat was almost ready to be launched. Still a lot of work left to do after she goes in the water though. Now it was time to try out these engines. Once we finally leave the yard, now it's time to use the boat for what it was built for. I hope you enjoyed the video. We've jumped over a lot of steps It's definitely biased, it's all from an engineer's point of view. But if you're into the same sort of thing, hopefully it's given you a better idea on how these boats are put together. And if you're mechanical minded and have thought of working on a boat, I'll put some links below in the description where you can find more information on the pathways into this job. Thanks for watching.